Hello and welcome to Accenture and CNBC TV 18 present Business Agenda for India in a Competing Digital World. On the panel today with me, I have Mr. Sanjay Davar, Managing Director, Accenture, Mr. Krishna Kumar, Vice Chairman and MD, Philips India, Mr. M.S. Unnikrishnan, Managing Director and CEO at Thermax, and Mr. Tapan Singhal, Managing Director and CEO at Bajaj Allianz General Insurance. Welcome, gentlemen. Now, Sanjay, let me start by asking you, you know, Accenture came up with this business agenda report, and can you throw some light on its key findings for us?
Sure. So this is a study which we do every year. And we do it both globally and also in India. And when we looked at the global findings, what we saw is that the overall business sentiment is looking up. But one key phenomena which we found in our findings was that the digital transformation was being looked at by CEOs globally in a big way. And therefore, we wanted to actually dive deeper into this in the India context, more so in the light of the fact that 60 to 70% of the Indian business CEOs are also saying that sentiment is improving, yeah, and hopefully so in light of the new government. But more so because of a focus on rural markets, focus on internationalization, focus on new service offerings, we wanted to really dive deeper and find out what do Indian CEOs think about the digital revolution.
Sure.
So that's really the background.
All right. Now, digital transformation, you know, more than other business changes, require a strong integration with technology and business executives, you know, and companies, there's a history of companies where they have strained IT relations, a handicap when they try to conduct digital transformations. So how important is going digital today?
Let me put the perspective from a B2B industry.
Sure.
Thankfully, we are an engineering company. We employ predominantly engineers, 75% of them. Workmen in the company, let's say the white and blue put together as engineers. Majority of my customers are qualified engineers. So in any case, there is a platform available, Spring Boot available for you to start on. So I believe that this industry has gotten into digitalization maybe 2 to 1.5 decades back in smaller way, isolated niche areas. Now it has become a generic way. Mm-hmm. If I go to look at the entire value chain of the business, starting with an inquiry management system, it's automated. It's through the wire.
Yeah.
Every inquiry is entered, and shifting of the platform from a budgetary inquiry to a serious inquiry to a negotiation platform, and registering the orders also from remote areas. A dealer can register an order from his office. It doesn't have to be sent through a paper. From there to doing an engineering, it's fully automated. You have standardized multiple things. Even in areas where such complicated things are available, you feed in two-dimensional diagrams of the various components coming into a plant, into a computer, to a server. It processes for maybe a 24 hours. You get a 3D standout of a full power plant. So you can walk through that, finding out the access points and the lifting points, exit points. Each one of them are physically visible to you in front of a computer. So there is no fouling. The time taken will be improved in that one. From there, when you do from engineering to procurement, is e-procurement today electronically? The suppliers. So entire value chain up to service commissioning, servicing, there is a remote performance monitoring system available. In a remote location, maybe in another continent, you can have a 24/7 data of the equipment running available. So there is an e-level, or maybe let me say digital ecosystem in existence within the company and outside. Mm-hmm. So I would say it is done, but is it good enough? No, we need to be improving more.
All right. Yeah. How important is going digital?
If we don't go digital, we don't exist. It is that important. As a service industry, for us it is the customer experience, which is everything. It's no more about products, about policies now. It's about the offering. No, it's an end-to-end feel for the customer. And the customer wants simplicity, easy to understand, convenience to transact. So for us, it's not about an IT department and about the rest, like you mentioned. For us, everybody has to be an IT person, in the sense that at least he or she should be IT enabled, IT aware, and should be fascinated by the changes.
Krishna Kumar, no digital, you don't exist. Do you agree with him?
Completely. I mean, we as a company, as Philips, we are a 50% B2B and a 50% B2C company. We are focused on health and well-being as a space, and we do that through three core businesses that we have of lighting, consumer lifestyle, and healthcare. And what we find very commonly is that while we are focused on addressing three key needs that exist. Regardless of the TG that we address, we target TGs from 14 to 18 through our businesses in personal care, male grooming, beauty. Yeah. We target customer groups from 25 to 35 through kitchen appliances, residential lighting, etc. And then 35 to 50 through our B2B businesses of healthcare and professional lighting. What we find as a common theme is really that digital enables you to have one-on-one relationships with your customers. And it's the deeper and more intimate your relationship with your customer, the more indispensable you become in adding value to your customer. Right, and so digitization, therefore, core to our strategy, therefore, as a company, is really building those deep, intimate relationships of adding value to our customers on the B2C as well as B2B side. And core to executing on that is to be the most digitally enabled company in the spaces we play.
You know, Sanjay, India's digital scene is disrupting like never before. We've got smartphone penetration that is estimated to touch 400 million by 2016. In the same year, we are estimated to be the world's largest population on Facebook, and even the e-commerce industry is pegged to touch the $8 billion mark by 2016. Despite this huge consumption of digital data and analytics, you know, there is a laid-back attitude of people investing in digital technologies and leveraging digital technology for growth. Your comments on that?
First of all, I don't think it's a, I wouldn't call it laid-back. Okay. What I'd say is, I think there is to some extent a lack of awareness. Let me start with something very simple. You know, what is digital?
Yeah.
I think you won't find a common definition of that. Often it's confused with the technologies, you know, social, mobility, analytics, cloud, acronyms like SMAC. But digital is more than that. See, technology makes it possible. A digital business needs to be profitable. Sure. Yeah. So I think there's that awareness that needs to be created about what is digital. That's the first point I'd make. Second is, I think in India, where you've got such a large young population, the fact that they've already adopted digital is forcing companies, and Oni was talking about it earlier, the ecosystem is forcing companies to go digital. Sure. Because the consumer in a B2C environment is expecting the company to interact with them in a digital fashion. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a reality. And I like to therefore use the sentence, every business is a digital business. So the awareness is the first part. And then the second part is, how do you leverage it for business growth, yeah, and cost optimization?
Explain to us in a layman's language the thin line, the difference between digitization and digitalization.
Okay, so as you'd notice in the report, the reason we make the distinction between digitization and digitalization is that, think of it like being digital vis-a-vis feeling digital. Mm-hmm. So let me explain that. So if you were to digitize a existing process or create a new channel, like a e-tailing channel for your business, sure, we refer to that as a digitization. So you're taking an old process, you're applying some new technology to it, and you're making it actually feel digital. But being digital is what is digitalization. And let me take an example. Today, you know, the Reserve Bank of India has granted new banking licenses. These new license companies have the opportunity to create a business model which is completely different from the existing business model. So today's banking is very branch centric. Tomorrow's banking will be very device centric. But that throws a challenge. You've got to have a consistent experience around that, yeah, particular different platforms of digital. It could be a smartphone, it could be a tablet, it could be your computer at home, it could be actually walking into the branch, still feeling the same thing. That business model created in a digital world is what we are calling digitalization.
Okay.
So it's new to new technology to new process, rather than new technology to an old process.
From a customer point of view, you know, banks and Bajaj Allianz is a huge financial services company. You know, you guys have digitized yourself from the customer's end totally. This digital renaissance, what opportunities has it opened for you to really improve your top line growth?
Thank you, Shruti. First, I'd like to respond to Sanjay's comment.
Okay.
One, I agree with you. It's not about awareness to that extent, because Newton's law, no, still is very relevant to human beings. If something in a state of rest continues to be in a state of rest. Second, I don't also agree that you have to look at the ecosystem to respond. That is too defensive. It has to be always be transformational. So the ones who make it big are the ones who set the ecosystem, no? And that reminds me when Henry Ford was asked about customer expectation. He said, if I ask the customer, they would ask for faster cars, faster horses, no? And I gave them cars. Or Steve Jobs says, what does the customer know about? From an insurance perspective, it's about the experience to a customer. If you look at insurance technically, I think we still sell very traditional products, automobile. And as I mentioned earlier, if Google car comes in, what does automobile insurance have to do? Which is about half of the insurance business across the world, you know. Second, if I look at the lifestyle changes now, from a perspective, if I look at my parents, how many times would they have gone on a vacation, or what kind of vacation? If I look at myself or my children, you have all the ski vacations, you have people, you know, moving out on weekends and all. So requirement of protection changes. It has to be on the spot. It has to be very customized. It has to be, if somebody is leaving the airport, he or she should get a message that, do you want travel insurance right now? And the person should say, yes, there it is. So that's why I mentioned that if you don't turn digital, if you don't set the ecosystems, you don't redefine your products, if you don't really relook into what the customer wants and experience, it's not only about claims now, about now claims being paid about a couple of hours earlier. It's about the entire experience. I think, I remember after the Nirbhaya case in Delhi, we came out with the assistance for women drivers, where if your tire bursts and you're traveling from Gurgaon to Delhi on, that's about 11 in the night, and you're afraid to step out, you can just give a call and somebody would come and change your tires. Now, that's not purely insurance as such, but it's the experience of being our customer that should be redefined. And that is where, Sanjay, you know, I think it's a bit different from our philosophy, the way I look at it.
You know, how do we really, this digital renaissance in India, how does that materially translate into the opportunities to drive top-line growth for corporate India?
No, so again, what our research throws up is that while your digitization opportunities, which, you know, we've heard a number of examples, lent more towards cost efficiency, there can be improvements in top line also. I think you need to start migrating towards digitalization to really get that growth through a digital premium. So example of this would be, as Uni goes overseas, there could be solution offerings which are related to service which could be digitalized for their customers. So, you know, a lot of the remote monitoring could happen out of India, and the service engineer goes only when some preconditioned monitoring is suggesting there's likely to be a breakdown. Now, if that gets packaged into the pricing of that particular offering, what you've done is you've earned a premium on that offering. At the same time, you've optimized cost, and therefore you've expanded margin. So you have to, as a group of CEOs, and you would have seen the articulation of opportunities on both digitization and digitalization, as CEOs set the agenda. Yeah. And I think this space of top line growth is primed to be picked.
All right, you know, we've heard about the opportunities that this space throws up, but still, then what are the barriers that corporate India faces to really move on from a traditional approach to being digital?
First and foremost, in my opinion, the generation of CEOs in the country currently have not gotten into a digital world when they got educated.
True.
They were, in my opinion, transformation and migration is possible for a human being. But I'm afraid to say that not everybody who's occupying the corner rooms of the country are digital in thinking to start with. So even if you allow CIO to perform, CIO specifically to perform, the company won't move along with this push and the pressure. It has to be that prime mover has got to be the CEO. So CEO has got to belong to the current world of digitalism. That has got to be the must. And I would say it's much easier for India. Why? If I were to be a CEO for an American company or a European company which is fairly developed in infrastructure, companies are very well set, only you need to be running, the kind of infra change that you got to do will cost you a hell of a lot of money. But over here, we're going to be creating edifices. So India has got a great opportunity to create a digital world and digital industry also, provided the person at the helm decides. Because the advantage for him is, if he's digital, he's got the youngsters in the company who are born into that world.
Yeah.
And you only need to be having that barrier of the middle management to be broken, then you can have a floodgate open to make it happen.
Sure.
And there he's got to think in terms of the world is changing, the world is going to be, customer is going to be digital in any case, and thinking, how I'm going to delight him. Then every product has got to, every offering, every solution has got to undergo a transformation, which has to happen in the brain of the guy running the organization. Then others will stand up and make it happen. It's going to happen also in instant. It's going to happen.
You know, digital technology is also about complementing strategies with existing, with the new ones, complementing existing strategies with new ones. And so how does corporate India really adopt this digital technology? By just complementing it and not substituting these strategies.
Thankfully, most of the devices and solutions have some e-component in that. There is no more electrical engineering. Everything is electronic in nature. So there is, you're proximate to being digitalized. So it's adoption, it's not substitution needed for it. So what you need to do is that once the other side, end of the day, we can't be sitting in isolation and create a product and say customer buy it. That those days are gone. It has to be market based. So one has to understand what I have as a ware or a solution today, how it is being treated and used by the customer. If it is not available, then how can you elevate yourself even far ahead, so that he also has a better experience? If you think from the customer standpoint of view, he wants ease. He wants everything faster, cheaper, better.
Yes.
So how do I use business technology, a digital technology, to make all these three happen for him? I'm able to deliver it faster. I'm able to make it better and in any case cheaper. So then suddenly it will be hitting your top line automatically to the bottom line. It is possible.
You know, we would all agree that all these annual strategies and planning cycles are too slow and cumbersome. So what role can digital technology play to really speed up the whole decision making process in this fiercely competitive space? Your view.
I've started to mention a brief bit on it. I mean the power with digitization of data, right, is that your decision making can be much more robust if you have real-time data coming in, right? So if I know what air fryer is going off the shelf, or what mixer grinder is going off the shelf, or what kinds of lights are actually going off the shelf, and I know that real-time, my decision-making becomes much more robust, because one of the core challenges we have in any emerging market is quality of data, right? So at a very core, and really at the source of all strategy, is really good data at a source. And you know, there is no other way out than to digitize and to enable better quality data to come through and real-time decision-making based on that.
Ed, what, according to you, are the key features, talking about the future, what are the key features of digital businesses, and why do you think they'll thrive?
I would say two counts. One is, we have currently approximately a 2 trillion economy. 1.8 was the last year's number. Two, let's say that.
Yeah.
If you're going to be doubling that in the next maybe 10-year period, I'm giving a lot of raw for the government for that 10 years. The quantum of spend on IT, digitalization put together will not be less than a 5-6% of the total size of the economy.
Yeah.
For Indian, in America, it would be 10% also. What's the size of the economy? Then $4 trillion into 5% is equal to $200 billion, the size of the industry. Do you want any further calculation?
No.
That's a number.
All right. So, you know, before I let you all go, what is that one big reason that you would want companies to leverage the power of digital? We'll ask everyone. So first, let me go with you, Sanjay.
I think I'll put it very simply. In today's world, every business has to be a digital business. So it's not something you can ignore. It's a necessity, because otherwise you're going to be left out. You will not be proactive if you're not thinking about digital, very simply.
Krishna.
For us, it's goes back to the fundamentals of business. Every business, if it's run by a consumer or a customer, right, digitization enables you to do that, right? So I think the sheer power for us is really a consumer data feeding all decision making and driving everything that we do, and us in turn adding value to a customer using digital.
Mr. Tapan.
Yeah, this question was relevant 10 years back. Today, I don't think anybody in doubt about it. You know, the experience that I have, dawn to the light coming in, from dark to light, it's just an experience, just feel it, you know, it's there. You just can't ignore it. And if you ignore it, it's too late. And as I always believe that you have to be transformational. You have to just keep on changing models and do it very, very fast. And what we do today, after 1 year, has no relevance. No? That is something you should accept it and keep on going.
Mr. Unnikrishnan, your final comments.
The world is moving at such a fast pace. A human being will not be able to catch up without the help of digital and digital support. And he has got to make it as an enabler, supporter, and possibly a vehicle to catch up every one of us and each of our businesses.
All right, gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us on this special. That's a wrap on this special episode. Keep watching CNBC TV18.